Buonasera.
Good evening. We have all been struck by the tragic news of tonight's earthquake. So today,
iniziamo I lavori con un momento di silenzio.
We start our encounters with a minute of silence, all together standing up. Thank you.
Aggiungo che
I would like to add that we invite you as mating to join solidarity initiatives that are going to be launched, and in particular we invite you to join the national fundraising campaign promoted by the Italian Bishop Congress that is going to take place on September the 18th, very soon, 17th and 18th, through Caritas organization. We join the words of Pope Francis, and we would like to express our deepest grief to the victims and their families and relatives, and this is an additional reason to delve into these topics in an even more serious way, because we really need all our seriousness and passion and attention to cast our eyes towards our brothers and sisters in the Middle East, towards the peoples of Syria, Iraq, and the whole region, a region that is so dear to our hearts, a region that has been devastated for too many years by wars and bombs. It's a world that is populated by so many children and women and people, and maybe really this has become the part of the world where there is that third world war that has been sometimes evocated. So to us Italians and Europeans, that world, it's our you. That's how we see it, feel it, perceive it, the Middle East. This is how we have perceived it all through the history of the mating. We had so many testimonies and encounters and conferences with the people from that you, from that world. This is part of us, of our story, of our growth. We would like to do so much more for these you. Unfortunately, our action is limited, but our efforts are relentless, and we will never stop deploying all our efforts to help them and support them. We're going to tackle this issue with two extraordinary guests. So we have Father Firas Lutfi, Syrian. Franciscan, and he's a Holy Land guardian, and we have been long friends with them. It comes from Aleppo, and you can imagine far too well, unfortunately, what does it mean to come from a place like Aleppo now? And he follows the San Francis parish. And then we have another extraordinary guest for different reasons, Jàn Figel from Slovakia. And very recently, he was appointed Special Envoy of European Commission for the Promotion of Freedom of Religion or Belief outside the European Union. And this is a new role, a new mandate. I think you were appointed 2 months ago. It's extremely important role, and we can say that this opens up a new era for Europe. So this is a great exceptional opportunity that we have today to have him here. So through Jàn Figel, we can really see a new era for Europe unfolding in terms of a representative role, in terms of mandate, in terms of skills, in terms of importance. So certainly, as Europeans, we are eager to do something about the freedom of religion or belief. This is extremely important. And I think that maybe since he was appointed in this position, this is one of the first times you have the opportunity to speak in public. So we are honored and privileged. I think this is a really meaningful moment in time for all of us. Minister Gentiloni, unfortunately, cannot be with us today because of the urgent commitment arisen because of the earthquake. In a minute, I will go back to our guests. But before that, I want to give the floor to Pasquale Valentini, Secretary of State for Political and Foreign Matters for the Republic of San Marino. So the Republic of San Marino is a republic with which the mating has a long-term historical relation. It goes beyond institutional relations. It's a partnership relation made of friendship and affection. And the presence of the Republic of San Marino is another sign of being open to the world. Thank you very much, Mr. Fontolan. Thank you to all of you. First of all, I would like to express my grief to the families and relatives of the victims of the earthquake for what happened last night. So all my sympathy to the victims and their relatives. Let's get back to our topic today. When it comes to building the peace, especially in a place that is so complex like the Middle East, it's such a demanding challenge that I think we are all called upon joining our forces to make this hope possible. Even the very tiny Republic of San Marino that is a member of the Council of Europe, of the UN, of the OCDE, in spite of its limited size and possibilities, feels accountable to do its part. And I'm pleased to say that there is a connection with our guest from Syria, but also with the initiatives rolled out by the European Union in this respect, because the Republic of San Marino has always reaffirmed its commitment and support. When it comes to the importance of this meeting here this afternoon, I would simply like to share a couple of remarks likely to guide us in the work we try to carry out to make our contribution. First of all, I think we need to focus on the religious dimension of every individual. It would be a very serious mistake to forget that, especially when we consider that this is an essential part of any individual. So the religious dimension of man is part and parcel of individuals. So we cannot deny considering this aspect when tackling any kind of issues. Secondly, when the international bodies look for solutions, should also consider the needs and requirements of daily cohabitation. We have several examples all over the world of peaceful cohabitation between different cultures and religions. So let's try to consider that. Sometimes international bodies and entities forget what maybe exists somewhere in the world and it's possible. So maybe they should get inspiration from those places of the world where peaceful cohabitation is already a reality. That is why the Republic of San Marino has always deeply appreciated what the mating in Rimini has been doing over the years, because this is very close to the mission we feel to have. And so we share so many values that I would like to thank you for what you have done so far, and thank you also for today's debate here this afternoon. Thank you very much indeed. Father Firas Lutfi arrived from Aleppo a few days ago. He has been sharing a couple of days with us here, and so we ask him to help us get a better understanding of these you. And we ask him to do so by introducing us to this beautiful land, which is Syria. Thank you very much. Thank you, Father, your testimony. Good evening, everybody. First of all, allow me to express in my own name and in the name of the Syrian people, and in particular in the name of those people who have been suffering for more than 6 years because of this terrible war, to express our deepest feeling of sympathy for these terrible earthquake that last night hit so many innocents, that devastated so many houses and homes, and that somehow make me think about what we see almost every day. And so I feel very close to the Italian people who are now suffering for that terrible earthquake. I would also like to express my deepest gratitude for this kind invitation. And I want to say that I was first undecided whether to accept this invitation or not, considering the situation I live in. You certainly know that Aleppo is an industrial city, a trade city. It's a lively city after the capital. It's the second most important city, but today it's also the most devastated one. It's a bit like Milan in Italy. In particular, the umbilical cord, so to speak, was cut at one point, because the only road connecting Aleppo to the rest of the world, I mean, to the other Syrian cities, to any other place in Syria, was cut 10 days ago because of an attack by jihadists and also a counter-offensive of the official Syrian army. Therefore, when I was invited, I said, thank you very much. I would be glad to accept the invitation, provided that the road becomes sort of usable again. And of course, it's not just a matter of having a road to travel along. It is also important to be able to travel down that road in a safe way. And when I left, the city was a ghost city. We were so few there. There was also Father Francesco Patton with me, and another father, Father Simone. And so, of course, The impression people have when they arrive is the following. So maybe some people have seen the devastation brought about earthquakes, but people never saw entire cities just brought to the ground and destroyed. And some people were pushed to come here, to come and visit us, the monks, the local monks, the local friars. And so many people were somehow encouraged to come to Aleppo because there were still some Christians there. There are still some Christians there, in spite of all the attempts to scare us, to expel us and kick us out. Well, I don't want to dwell too much on what is happening in Aleppo. Last year, Father Ibrahim said a lot and described our dramatic daily life, to what extent a family, a household, to just survive and have a livelihood that is below human dignity, has to strive every day, very hard. There's no power, there's no food, there's no safety. And we are sort of bombed every day, night and day. And I would like to quote Jeremiah. This can be very sort of clarifying. So the prophet Jeremiah, when talking about what happened some millennia ago, says, "The virgin daughter, my people, has suffered a grievous wound, a crushing blow. If I go into the country, I see those slain by the sword. If I go into the city, I see the ravages of famine." Well, there are not many swords around, but many bombs, yes. They hit every day, killing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of innocent people every day. The number of casualties so far has exceeded 380,000 people. The vast majority of them are children and women, more than half. And also the beautiful UNESCO World Site, which was Palmyra, a very important archaeological site. It was an icon and a symbol of Syria and its beauty, of the unique heritage we had. Well, that beautiful site is now like that. It was a beautiful country at the origin of the Apostolic Church. In the days of the Apostles, we were called Christians for the very first time. And all that beauty, these human patchwork, is now falling into pieces. So you see the before and after the attacks of ISIS. Unfortunately, you see what is left now. Right, so any archaeology professor knows this place, and in particular, one professor has been working for 40 years in Syria, and he worked in Palmyra, Professor Buccellati, who is here with his wife. And like me, I think, is refraining from crying while watching these pictures, because to him, those chains were full of life and history. They were and are a part of the human and mankind patchwork. So we are being all bled, all injured through these deeds. You see kids playing around the remains. We have three branches that are being managed by us. The most important center is the parish church and Father Ibrahim. I'm also the deputy sort of Father Ibrahim, last year he told you a lot about how the vault was destroyed through a missile, and fortunately 400 people were saved because of that, because they were weaponless and they were innocent. So these children keep on living in spite of the ruins all around. And so we have Saint Bonaventura di Bagnoregio here, and as patron saint, and this place is hit almost every 10 days. So we decided to stop, to refurbish that building, because every time we reconstruct it, then another bomb comes and destroys it again. So we are really sick and tired to keep on restoring that part of our monastery. However, if you have a look at that beautiful Madonna, which is a symbol of the resistance movement, it's a symbol of those resistance who did not even think about leaving the place in spite of the high level of destruction. And a few days ago, a father came to me and told me, okay, we have been able to survive starvation and thirst, the lack of power and electricity, but father, watching my kids being maimed or killed or hit by bombs, this is something I cannot really stand. So give me a christening certificate and I will go. These objects are not holy objects. We are bombed every week with this kind of thing. These are gas sort of containers, gas bottles filled as bombs. So this is what jihadists send us, especially in Christmas and during the Easter season. And so when the families are reunited, they launch those bombs. And here you see an image of the many innocents looking for a place to have some peace for them and for their relatives. Recently, on May the 21st, this is my house. This is a former facility devoted to Saint Anthony from Padua. We welcomed a couple of dozens of ancient and sick people after their shelters and houses were destroyed. So we welcomed them with joy and devotion. I don't know if you notice a window, and well, actually it's not a window, that hall was created by a missile. A 94-year-old person died, René Salen, rest in peace. And then another couple of injuries. By a whisker, a missile almost hit another window. If that happened, so many ancient people would have died. So that was a near miss. I consider that near miss as a deed of God. Those people were lucky. They are our guests. Every time bombs are launched, these people cannot sleep. However, their hearts have been put to the test very hardly, because now they do not feel safe, not even in the monastery. Here you see the 94-year-old woman who died, Renee. Sorry for this harsh image. These woman was saved and rescued. She's in a crucifix-like position almost. And here you see the remains of the bombs. More than one was launched onto our house. So the title of this debate is hoping, the hope against all hope, working for peace. Well, we do not accept to leave. We do not give up. We need to stay, to remain, and to reconstruct. And I was able to put all those bricks in place, those bricks that had been discarded by the bomb. But this is a symbolic deed. There are people who are not, I mean, they are unhappy. A terrorist, a jihadist, is not bad by definition. It was also made on the image of God, but their ideology is wrong, so some specific background made them take the wrong direction, the wrong road, so probably nobody told them that the other is good for them. And then we have these women. These old women are a good for me, are a great good. And these people do not ask much. They simply want to be taken by the hand to make the transition to the other world. And again, we are here, I am here to show to what extent we want to rebuild these devastated Syria and save it from hatred, intolerance, and from regionally mental approach. We do not accept that. We are builders of bridges, of peace, of dialogue. We are peacemakers. And but all that is extremely difficult. Here, I would simply like to quote these beautiful words by Pope John Paul II. He thought about the same kind of situation generated by war, desperation, and situations that cannot be bad by humans. We need to re-enhance the certainty that there is somebody keeping the destiny of the world in their hands. Somebody who has the keys of both the dead and the AIDS, somebody who is the Alpha and Omega, and this individual is love. Love that turned into flesh and that lives among people. Those people are somehow a symbol of what people need to live every day. So bread is not enough, as Jesus would say. So we need affection. We need charitable gestures. We need mercy. We need compassion. Mercy is about sharing the suffering, the need to identify with another person suffering, and that handshake was authentic. So this handshaking is a gesture of trust and confidence. That was a member of the Syrian parliament. These are some Syrian friends. They come quite often, at least twice a month. It's voluntary workers of the Red Cross. And they always come in bringing a smile. They come just to tell these people who were so hardly hit by something so dramatic and traumatic to tell, okay, we are here as well in spite of the suffering and of the darkness. We are here, so you are a good for me. And apart from the welcoming activities, we have another 60 children who are deaf-mute. This one is learning to listen and somehow to talk his own way. And this is a unique school in Aleppo. The area the school is in is constantly bombed. So, f- feeling a great hope for the smallest, the least, as Jesus calls them. We would have never been able to create a school for them. This year, they were able to make the examination to access junior high school. So the whole staff of the school, because practically all of them are voluntary workers, but they do something so valuable, they certainly need to be supported and helped. So accepting the hope, the challenge of hope means realizing one's own being human. So trying to face any difficulty, even though evil sometimes seems to prevail. Another gesture of hope is the following. We had a summer camp for youngsters. It was for 350 youngsters and plus 100 compared with last year. And the bombing was carried out not far from the place where they used to celebrate the first days of the camp. Of course, we have to live with fear every day, but we never gave up so far. We have shouted with our children, we want joy, we want happiness, we want peace, we want to dance, we want to live. We want to be considered as God's creatures. I would really like you to be able to feel and also to listen to something. Please.
Voglio gioire.
I want to be joyful. I want to sing. I want to do my homework at school. I want to hear the bell ring in my school. I want to make my dream come true as any other individual. I want to live. I want to live peacefully. So please, our Lord, do not forget us. You protect us. And 1 month ago in that place, we had that missile. Look at the window that killed one person. So jihadism, evil, human meanness is something that can ruin our inner peace. We want to overcome any evil form through the good. So having so many young people shouting out loud they want to live peacefully in friendship, it's so important because war is really destroying everything. So men need not just bread but also opportunity to live, opportunities to be empowered and try to do everything they want to become a full human being. And so far, thanks to many donors, especially Italian ones, we were able to clean the swimming pool that we still have in our Sant'Antonio facility. Look at the joy of these children. And then we have a trainer, and the trainer told us that many of them forgot even how to swim because they hadn't come to the swimming pool for a very long time. You see them, they are saying hello and they are waving to say hello to all the participants of the meeting in Rimini. Right, so last year we had no water. it was impossible, it was contradictory to have a pool while people were dying because of thirst. This year, we are not experiencing the same water shortage problem. We were able even to dig a specific well in my garden. So we have really 400 people in our monastery. And again, this is what you would find with us, peace, tranquility, joy, happiness. But of course, it's important to have certainty to make the present possible. So Christianity was not just good news, it was the communication of things that were not known. So we would say that the Christian message was performing and not just forming. So that means that the gospel is not just a communication of things and knowledge and information. It's a communication that changes things that can make fruit a tool to better understand everything. And we have to state out loud that hope is something precious. We need to be the first conveyor of this message, because of course we are worried, but not specifically about ourselves, but about all the people surrounding us. And we also want to build a peace culture in Aleppo, in Syria, but also in all war countries. Everything is polluted and contaminated. The air that we drink, the food, everything is contaminated. Everything. And there is a lack of culture, and there is the culture of violence, hatred, and terrorism. How can we save our young people? By offering a special education to respecting the other, welcoming the other, without forgetting our own identity, who we are. We are like a guardian of God in that land, and we were given its gospel. We are Christians in our DNA, and we're very happy and proud of that, but we're not selfish. We are not closed into an ivory tower, into our small egos. We're not confined onto an island, because we think that we can also be a gift for the others, for the other. All the conflicts in the Middle East are generated by one main reason: greed. The greed to get everything, either all or nothing. And then we also need to accept forgiveness. We need to forgive the others. So there was the eye for eye, teeth for teeth law. But this was not just a Jewish law, but also Muslim law. I mean, we need to stop this vicious circle of violence. And Christians have a concrete response. It's up to Jesus, who forgave his perpetrators. Not because it justifies the suffering and pain, but simply because he tries to understand if a person is unhappy or what happens to her. Again, so the Holy Land is also a place of hope. That's how we want to see it, and that's the message I want to leave you with. This is a picture I took from my window in Aleppo, and that tells me so much. We live in almost continuous darkness, like a tunnel of which we cannot see any light. It's not a civil war, but it's really a world war. We simply need a gift from the sky, from heaven, likely to give us, provide us with some peace. Every day the sun is there, but we do not even notice that. So that's an additional reason to hope, because even the longest and darkest night will end. Everything goes by. Everything that has a beginning also has an end. And we do hope that the Sun of Peace and Justice will, at the end, give us the opportunity to stop with this suffering. And we hope that at the end of the day, we will have peace as a gift. And in Syria, and this could be another very interesting topic, maybe also for Mr. Figel. A priest from San Marino 3 years ago, he was murdered with 7 shots by Jesus groups on the border with Turkey, very close to the Turkish border. He didn't accept to leave his sheep. 7-8 people, he said, no, I won't go, I stay here until my believers are there, my churchgoer, and I've been here for a certain time. I remember that there was the need for a person to provide temporary coverage. And I had to come across with a very difficult situation. So we also had to take the body of this Marty. And I don't know if you know what it means to go through the so-called Death Valley. And along the road, I had sort of repeated, my Lord is my shepherd all along the way. I don't have to fear anything because, God is with me, the Lord is with me. And I celebrated the funerals of this martyr, but I also had to take care of 3 sisters who were ancient and sick, old and sick, and frightened to death. They waited for their death. Fortunately, we were able to reach that village that now is in the hands of ISIS, and nobody really could move. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if I'm here, if I'm alive, is to tell you that many people showed hope, and they are also today driven by hope. They are there to live and to spread around peace. Father van der Lachte, Father Murat, Father van der Lachte was a Jesuit missionary priest, decided to remain in spite of the cause of his embassy. He decided to stay close to the poorest Christians and Muslims. And even before the deal between government and the Jesuits was made, he was murdered. Father Jacques was also a victim of terrorism. Very often we're asked, are you afraid of terrorists? Well, actually, fear is a very natural human feeling. But those who believe in God, who is the God of life and history, I think can really overcome some fears, especially if we keep in our heart what St. Paul had in his life. So nor life, neither angels, nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And this rainbow was also taken by me. I hope one day you will be able to come to Aleppo. You are all warmly invited. And we show you all this. So you are all really very welcome. So again, let's now see some peace. I hope we're going to see some peace very soon. And in particular, I hope that all the people who are suffering because of persecutions and wars will be able to enjoy some peace. I hope weapons of death will be silenced to open up a new era of peace and tranquility. Thank you very much for being so patient to listen to my words. These very long round of applause Father Firas, this long applause is the most simple and easiest way to express to you our feelings as your barrister, as your Muslim friends told you, we are there with you. Maybe today we can just clap our hands, but this is an expression of the desire to be with you with all our forces. Thank you very much. Now, as I told you, we have another great guest. Jan Figel comes from Slovakia. He has a very long political career. He was European Commissioner, and he came to the meeting. So this is your second time here with us. He came in 2007. At that time, he was a Commissioner for Education, Training and Culture. And here he is with us with a new role and position, and we're eager to know and understand why together, and we would like to give our contribution to open up a new era in the history of the European consciousness in relation to this topic. Thank you very much for being here.
Buonasera a tutti. Grazie, Roberto. Grazie per l'invitazione a Rimini. I do have to start with expressing my deep condolences to families and relatives of all victims of today's earthquake, and also my solidarity with Italian people. What happens and happened confirms that we are all vulnerable, mortal, and we need each other even more. 37th edition calls for respect and appreciation, because Comunione and Liberazione nurtures already second generation of young and less young Italians for culture of dialogue, culture of friendship, ethics of responsibility. This is important for you, for your bel paese, for Italy, for common Europe, but also for better world. Why I'm here again? Because I'm invited, and I thank you. And I also learn here. I get a lot of inspiration. Like we could share now a testimony from Syria, from Father Firas. I was here as Commissioner for Education and Culture. A lot has happened, and a lot has changed since that time. Yes, now I am here as special envoy for promoting freedom of religion or belief outside the European Union. And it's something really new. Maybe late or delayed, but at least now European Union gives clear signal that freedom of religion is essential value, and it is important ad intra and ad extra, and that we want to care more about it. It was expressed in Rome, in Vatican, at the solemn ceremony when the Pope Francis was awarded by Charlemagne Prize. As a great European, although he's coming from Argentina, I think it was the right decision. And European Union and institutions wanted to express not only appreciation, but also commitment to act, to do something more for freedom of religion and human dignity in the world. Because human dignity is the first value which unites us, not only here. We are all equal in dignity, and we are all different because everybody is an original. That's a principle of creativity and creator. And freedom of any person starts with freedom of conscience, continues with freedom of thought, freedom of belief, of religion, freedom of expression, freedom of association, freedom of assembly. And it is also freedom to change one's religion or not to believe. We are all free. And all we should care for this gift. Because religious freedom in today's world, in 21st century, is under strong pressure, and the tendency is negative. There is less and less freedom. And our best answer to gift of freedom in Europe is to care for it and to help freedom to promote human dignity. I got mandate for 1 year only. It's beginning, but beginning which is important to establish agenda, priorities, relations, actions, and then to build a real agenda for freedom of religion in the world. I see several priorities in the world. Number one is Middle East, for several reasons I will come to. Then, of course, Southern and Southeast Asia, Northern and Central Africa. And then there are several thematic priorities, because there are different ways how the freedom is oppressed or limited. For example, we have in the world totalitarian regimes, as we had in Europe. There are legislative acts on blasphemy, which are frequently misused against minorities. There are countries with caste discrimination. And there are countries and regions where ethnic and religious minorities suffer from violence. I came here to contribute to the debate about hope for Middle East. But it is connected with the hope for Europe, for all of us. We live in time when we can say, at least it's my opinion, that we could and should close the century of wolves. Century which was so bloody with world wars, two hot wars, one cold war, bloody borders, inhuman inventions like gulags, concentration camps, gas chambers. All of this started in Europe, which was actually also a century of genocides. Recently, German Bundestag, German Parliament, voted a resolution saying that mass killing of Armenians in 1915, 1916 was a genocide. So one century. And in the time between, we had Nazi liquidation camps. We had genocidal killing in Cambodia, in Rwanda, in Bosnia. And now I think we have genocidal acts in the Middle East. And I mean it. It is a serious expression under the international law. So what shall prevail after this century? It depends on a relatively simple answer. Will prevail fear and indifference, or humanity and solidarity? Because the fruits of the first are crimes of inhumanity, and fruits of the other is peace, reconciliation, stability, and prosperity. To say bene per me, or to say problem per me. This is a paradigm, this is a question. Because if we understand our humanity as one family, the approach is different. If we fragment, segment, divide, then we start from the wrong beginning. These meetings in Rimini for decades are meetings of hope, of a dialogue, of friendship. And it builds up mentality of hope. Our source of hope is faith and reason, both. It belongs to everybody as a gift. But if we use it with responsibility, we are stronger. We don't share fear but courage. And we share brevity, as we could see from Franciscan Fathers in Aleppo. Middle East, as Roberto said, is part of us. I think it is a litmus test what shall prevail in the new century. Because Middle East is a gravitational focal point of the whole world. It's a crossroad of international or global relations. It's a place where our cultures and civilization have roots and meeting place of three monotheistic religions. Yesterday we heard about the meeting of two important brothers in faith. Patriarch of Rome and Patriarch of Moscow, Pope Francis and Patriarch Kirill. Maybe delayed, could be sooner. It was first ever, but it happened. And it was a meeting for commitment to do something, to help, to show brotherhood in concrete steps. I think we are still waiting or doing not enough for Abrahamic togetherness. If Christian togetherness is delayed, we need to speed up. But the next step is the recognition and promotion of Abrahamic togetherness. And I mean this also as a civilizational aspect. In the Universal Charter of Human Rights, there are many rights. You may count them. And there are only two duties, two obligations for anybody. And one of them is to behave in the spirit of brotherhood to each other. It is enough to balance all rights. So what I want to stress here is famous and clear. Truth liberates. We need to know the reality, the facts about Middle East. Because acceptance of truth is base for justice. And justice is base for peace. And peace is base for stability and prosperity. Relatively simple to express, difficult to achieve. But we need to work on that. So that's why we support Geneva peace talks on Syria, humanitarian assistance, but also military activities, especially in Iraq, where global coalition, together with Iraqi security forces, is gradually liberating territory from ISIS. Defeat of ISIS and elimination of this organization is a precondition for peace and stability in the Middle East. The crime which is committed there frequently ranks very high. These are war crimes, crimes against humanity. But in many messages we could see, we could witness, we could hear about systematic, long-term, and focused liquidation of religious and ethnic minorities, being they Christians, Yazidis, Shia Muslims, or others. In 1948, there was a convention on genocide adopted after the tragic World War II. The motto of that time was never again, never again. But many times since then, we have broken this promise. Recently, there was a book published with the title Never Again. It is about legal response to a broken promise in the Middle East. Because if in the previous cases we needed to prove crimes exposed, now it's online. But the perpetrators declare their ideology. They spread fear through images, through broadcasting, social networks. What happens there in short time is seen probably the most on persecution of Christians. In Iraq, the number of Christians since 2003 decreased from 1.4 to roughly 1.4 million to 260,000, according estimations. In Syria, since 2011, from over 2 million to less than 1 million. People are expelled from their homes by ISIS, women raped, hijacked, enslaved, killed, or tortured. These mass and systematic atrocities have been denounced and labeled as a genocide by Council of Europe, European Parliament, Congress and State Department of the United States, British Parliament, and Australian Parliament. I think time comes to speak about it. Also here in Italy, in Italian Parliament, and in other parliaments. We need to give voice to voiceless. We need United Nations for action, for more efficient and more constructive action on the level of Security Council and International Criminal Court. Because our role is threefold. First, to stop atrocities. Second, to help victims. And the third, to prosecute crimes. Because justice is important. Then forgiveness makes sense. But crime has to be named. Criminals called to independent court after independent investigation. And then momentum comes. I think we need to stop the chain of perpetual revenges, bloodshed, violence as instrument. But first, we need to stop what's going on there. So, is there a hope for Middle East? My answer, and I think our answer, is yes. Because hope for Middle East is our hope. How many people 70 years ago would say Europe may become area of hope? After so bloody world war, now we cannot even imagine war between France, Germany, Italy. And this was the dream, but also commitment of Schuman, Adenauer, De Gasperi. They didn't have more power. They had more courage, commitment, faith, and reason to build via practical steps, practical solidarity, a community of peace. L'Orient Proche, Near East, neighborhood is close to us and should be close to us also mentally and in our hearts. Nemo dat quod non habet. We can give only what we have. So we need to share European hope that it's possible to reconcile and to build community of people, community of values, community of rules. And religions can help. They are frequently misused, as they have been misused in Europe many times in the past. Dividing line is not between cultures and civilizations. if there is any dividing line, it potentially goes through our heart and mind. And it's up to us what we support. Dividing line is between fanaticism on one side and human dignity, respect for human dignity on the other side. And in our history, there were many sources and phenomena of fanaticism. Religious, atheist, ideological, political, ethnic, but also great inspirational cases of responsibility. We have to promote moderate forces and partners within Islamic communities. We need more education, more dialogue, but also more cooperation of cultures and religions. Because ignorance breeds intolerance. I want to conclude by expressing again the nomination of a special envoy for religious freedom came with the ceremony in Rome. Pope Francis got this Charlemagne Prize, I think, for many deeds and ideas, including his first visit to Lampedusa, and then also including his visit to Lesbos and taking in several families. Pope Francis reminds that Jesus Christ was also a refugee. So I want also to thank him publicly for his inspirational example and personal testimony. Visiting your exhibitions here, I want to also pay tribute to constructive struggle of Italian Italians with the waves of refugees and migrants, for your humanitarian corridors. This is a great example of solidarity and humanity. My friends, siblings of evil are two, inter alia, and they are called fear and indifference. We shouldn't be afraid, and we should act according to justice and humanity. I was encouraged here, not only by example from yesterday, but also the day before, one from yesterday was from the conversion of former criminal Daniel from Brazil into a great personality. Saul and St. Paul, Dismas. These cases are real and important for all of us to decide for good, for common good. Secondly, great Mufti of Croatia from Zagreb visited and wants to continue to visit Islamic countries to ask Islamic leaders to treat Christian minorities with respect as Muslim minorities are treated in dominantly Christian countries in Europe. He wants to ask Islamic leaders to behave like Pope Francis. This is great confirmation of a golden rule. Do the others what you want the others to do to you. That's simple. So, my dear, your motto here, to say un bene per me, reminds me an idea of French philosopher, theologian Paul Ricoeur. La chemin le plus court de moi à moi, c'est l'autre. Everybody needs somebody else to find it himself, herself. So in this spirit, I thank you. And I wish you that spirit of Rimini is spread not only in Italy, but also in the international community. Thank you, all the best.
Dopo aver ascoltato.
After listening to Jàn Figel, I can say that we really not need such a Europe. Maybe it's a bit late, but we can start. And so we are eager to collaborate with people like you, with men like you. Thank you very much indeed for the very important and beautiful things that you said, very important things. And this is the sign, the clear sign of a new will by Europe, a new willingness. I would like to quickly go back to Father Firas, and I also seize this opportunity to say hello to some diplomat friends. I see the ambassador of Honduras at the Holy See with his wife. I know that this is not part of the protocol, but in my opinion, he's the head of all the voluntary workers of the meeting, ideally, because he promoted and designed the exhibition on mercy, and it will take it on tour all around the world, and we have known each other for quite some time, so I wanted to publicly thank him, even if it's not part of the formal protocols. I also see the friends from Coreis, the Italian Islamic religious community that are following us as well with a lot of friendship. They have been with us for a long time. And again, thanks also to the work done by Sheikh Pallavicini and for his great work. Thank you very much for your presence. So another few seconds with Father Firas. Firas is the correct pronunciation. Thank you. Oh, yes, he was telling me that Firas means the good skills of the tiger, of the horse and of the Leo, of the lion, sorry. So this is a quite complex name, but still. Over the years, we have invited many, many people from those lands, from that region, and maybe this is a selfish act, because we need to listen to people like you. Our possibility to do something comes only after listening to voices like yours, because you are helping us somehow first. Any helping deed is a way to open up to the other, and it's the opening act to a pathway of action. But living there is an act of heroism, I think. So maybe we are selfish, but we need you. We need to listen to you. We need to learn something from you, from people like you. That said, we do not want to be non-grateful. So our applause was not formal at all. I think it was spontaneous, and it was an expression of how much we really want to feel close to you, to be close to you and the people you live with and you are surrounded by. How can we do something for you? Can we do something in return? How can we give back something to you? Well, first of all, I do not, what we do, we do it simply because we feel doing it. We feel the duty and the need to do it. We are urged to do it, and we feel empowered like that. So that's it. And also, it's nice to stay there and to be there because everything comes from the east. The sun comes from the east every day. And this is a sort of holy pride that we see every day. And as Jesus said, those who gave a lot will be asked a lot. So if we have been given such a grace to be born in the Holy Land, the land of the patriarchs like Abraham, but before him, Adam and Eve, our forefathers. And so we have the honor and the burden, onore et onere. So we need to take advantage of that gift, but any great gift entails great responsibility. So what could you do with respect to what you heard? Well, I arrived in Rimini on the 20th, and some friends invited me in the main square in Rimini because usually there is a praying moment. It is made all together, and we say the rosary all together. Then if there is a special occasion, they invite guests. So I was invited as a special guest. And I did not come here to show you that I'm a good and I speak a good Italian, not at all. For instance, I think that it's important to show you what is happening there in that part of the world, to explain to you what your father, your brothers and sisters there live and experience. So again, being sympathetic is already something you are doing for them. And praying is a great and important act. I'm a believer, and Mr. Figel said that we need to respect everybody's beliefs, also those who do not believe. However, my vocation, my joy stems from my faith. I can't help believing because that helps me even in that extremely difficult and tragic context and setting. So where I ask my friends scattered all around the world using the symbol used by St. Paul, talking about the church as a single body, but they are all limbs. All the believers are limbs and the head is Christ. So if one is joyful, in a few days' time, Mother Teresa will become a saint, but we are all happy for our sister. So a sister made of our flesh and bones being named as a saint. Everybody should be happy, even the Buddhists, those who met her in Calcutta, for instance. But similarly, when one of the limbs is suffering, the one limb of these body, all the other limbs are suffering. So praying is important, sharing is important, feeling part of the same family, of the same body, and mutually respecting each other spiritually. But then, of course, you can also do something else according to your own role. I'm not a politician, but, and here Mr. Figel, before getting into the conference hall, we had the chance to exchange a few words about the role of politicians from the international community. Well, it's important not to carry out a policy of exploitation or a policy protecting and defending the interests of one country, or trying to carry out a policy that tries to protect people and not harm people. And again, Well, when it comes to the role of a journalist should convey the truth. If journalists convey the truth of what is being experienced in Syria, in the Middle East, in hot places where war is extremely dangerous, is another important thing. So informing people and not misinforming people, and this is also very important. So it's not about conveying useless information. It's about trying to do our share in that respect. So praying and then doing your role at best according to what you do in your life. And thirdly, trying also to make an economic contribution, because of course there's nothing bad in saying that, because every person, every poor person needs some help. And again, we also have to make the most of the money that we can collect. I'll make another couple of examples. Sorry if I'm dwelling too much, but this is such a hot topic. Just another couple of quick examples, totally authentic. In the primary school of Grosseto in Italy, I remember talking to children about the suffering in Syria, of children as well. And I remember that a few months after my first visit, I was extremely surprised. They gave me a little envelope and told me, "Father, this is the money that we collected as children for your children of your summer camp." These gestures are incredible. It was a little sacrifice, but so impressive. They said, "We simply renounced to a new pair of shoes or an ice cream. We saved money and we simply made three holidays instead of six." And so these envelopes is about little deeds that we made, little sacrifice for our kindred brothers and sisters in Syria. And for instance, I don't know, again, there are many young couples that get married and decide to donate the money that is given to them by families and relatives as a celebration to people in need. Again, I said that praying is important, and then fulfilling one's own role in the best possible way. And third, practical generosity made with hearts. Another second for you, Mr. Figel. So you were born in Czechoslovakia, and then you went through many changes in your life. You saw Europe changing under your eyes radically, deeply. And you worked a lot in European institutions. And how do you feel about this new role that you have personally? Because I almost feel that it's not just a job for you, a political commitment, but maybe like a mission, a service you're fulfilling, something, I mean, that goes beyond a simple role. Sorry if I say so, but this is the impression I have. This is really something I perceive.
Yeah, I think that everybody is invited to his or her role and mission. Whether we speak about priest, teacher, medical doctor, or politician, it depends how we understand life. If it is understood as a service to common good, I think that we find the right answers. My name, Jan Figel, belonged previously to my uncle, who was killed by secret communist services of Czechoslovakia in 1953. Many people could not answer such questions or live in common, free, peaceful Europe, including those of my family. My father died before the collapse of communism. And I want to say that those people would like to have our problems with euro, with economy, because they didn't have freedom, dignity, opportunities. Many people fled from Europe because it was divided, there was persecution. Now many people come to Europe. Which situation is worse for Europe? Or better to say, what is better for us? To be attractive or to be a fearful place for living? I spoke about gulags, mass graves, bloody borders, not 70 years ago only, but let's say 20 years ago in Western Balkans, not far from Rimini. So for me, Europe is a homeland of my homeland, patria de ma patria, a larger home. And it's different to be a tourist or to be a citizen here. I am citizen of Europa Nostra in Rimini, in Italy, because tourist comes and leaves. Those who feel affiliation care about. And I think that's the major point. We need to feel responsibility for the status, for the future of our home in Rimini, in Italy, in Europe. And of course, then it goes on. I don't want to speak much, but Christianity and skepsis doesn't go together. There are so many lessons, so many inspirational issues, figures. For any leader, the inspiration is the most important. And that's now a bit missing. But I want to encourage you, and I don't preach here. Since I was here last time, European Union, our union, our house, our home, went through several critical processes, from crisis to crisis. It was constitutional crisis after enlargement, when France and Netherlands said no, non, to new treaty. And we have the new treaty, and we have more members than 9 years ago. Then we got economic crisis or financial and economic crisis. You know about it a lot. Since that time, euro is stronger, more credible, more stable. And there are more members in the Eurozone. And current crisis, which is on refugees and migrants, is much more complicated, much more sensitive, because it's not about commodity, not about money or economy. It is about human beings. And I think that now the answer is even more important, and it's called integral humanity. which respects and promotes spiritual, cultural dimensions of each human being. Of course, together with social, economic, and material needs. Last, what I want to say, the most inspirational politician for me was and is Robert Schuman. And four small points he left to everybody. First, Europe as a bearer or holder of its destiny, which means Europe which is free, sovereign, which is not decided or commanded by the others. Secondly, Europe which is a leader of humanity, not only place for humanity but leading humanity. Third, Europe which is cradle of democracy, as a protector of democracy. And the fourth is also very important. Europe as example of universal solidarity, which is so important for Middle East, for Africa, for the whole world. I hope we are mature enough not only to speak about it, but to implement it. Set to.
Bene, grazie. Mi prendo.
Right. I so held you here a bit longer, but I think it was worth for such inspirational work. Thank you very much. Please get out very quickly because there's another meeting here in 10 minutes. So I hope you will forgive me for being a bit longer, but thank you. We had great guests. Thank you very much.